Kwe Tanse Sego. Hi, my name is Pam Palmater, and welcome back to my new YouTube channel, State of the Nations, where we will talk about critical issues impacting Indigenous nations all over our sovereign territories on Turtle Island. The integrity of Canada's policing and correction system has been brought into disrepute over a long period of time by continued and unabated racism, sexism, abuse, and corruption within various levels of police forces. This is a major concern, and it's something that should have been addressed a long time ago. Yet just this week, we have another reported incident in Canada of corrections officers doing what other people would be considered crimes. For example, in Edmonton Maximum Security, they recently suspended 7 employees, including managers, and they're engaging in several investigations for both sexual harassment and sexual assault amongst corrections officers. Male corrections officers are reported to have sexually assaulted female corrections officers, and when they tried to lodge complaints, they were retaliated against, further bullied, and allegations are that they have also breached safety protocols, putting their lives at risk for having made the complaints. And this is something that the unions in various provinces can attest to is an ongoing and long-standing problem in these primarily male-dominated organizations. Many people would think that this is just an example of a few bad apples, that the system is generally good, but there's just one or two people who are doing bad things, like you would find in any other aspect of society. The problem is with policing and corrections, it's not just a few bad apples. It is widespread. It is something that we've known about for a long time, but very little action has been taken. Recently in BC, there was another prison where the actual sexual assault of a female corrections officer was caught on camera, but no charges were brought against the male officer because they had determined that he had already suffered enough internally from the workplace consequences, and which sends a very clear message that sexual assault in the public can be a crime. But if it's the corrections officers or police officers doing sexual assault, well, that's just workplace misconduct, and it's not worthy of being considered a crime or for the victim to have any justice. And this is a huge problem. And unions in BC that represented several locals of corrections officers have also reported that they have been dealing with sexual harassment on behalf of their female corrections officers for a very long time, and it continues to be a problem. In 2012, prison guards in an Ontario women's facility have also been accused of abusing prisoners. What they were doing was trading items like tobacco and drugs for sex acts. Now, the Canadian Association of Elizabeth Fry Societies considers that to be sexual abuse because of the huge power differential between corrections officers and prisoners, who are literally at the mercy of those guards, and that consent would be hard to be given in a situation like that. But this is nothing new. Reports just like this all over the country have long been reported to the Corrections Service of Canada and also the Office of the Correctional Investigator. Prison advocates have long called for external reviews of such incidents. They've called for the elimination of male guards in women's prisons, and they've also called for an increased use of surveillance cameras to protect the prisoners and act as a record of incidents that do happen within the prisons. It is because of cameras that were installed in several Ontario and Quebec prisons that we were able to find out that prison guards in those institutions were beating prisoners. There were videos that depicted really severe beatings of prisoners as they were walking in between areas, and prisoners that were literally cowering in fear from the beatings, something that one of the lawyers called absolute terror. terrorism by prison guards for prisoners. They have no way to defend themselves, they're not armed, and they're literally at the mercy of those prison guards. And there's very few realistic options for reporting such violent beatings in fear of the ongoing retaliation. It has really created a scenario of injustice, and the use of cameras helps us deal with those circumstances and bring justice for those prisoners. The Office of the Correctional Investigator has said that 70% of the time, they're not able to access the camera footage. The camera is broken, there's no electricity, they can't find the footage, or there's some problem with the surveillance. In 70% of the time, which means that even in prisons which use camera surveillance, they're not complying with the surveillance requirements in 70% of the cases. Now, the Office of the Correctional Investigator also said that, to his mind, it's no coincidence that a large number of prisoner beatings that happen by corrections officers happen where there are no cameras or in between where the camera surveillance can reach. And that's a real problem. Cameras are really important. And in the case of Frank Paul, a Mi'kmaq from the East Coast who happened to be in BC, it helped determine exactly what was the cause of his death. And the cause of his death were the police taking him into the drunk tank, leaving him there, dragging him out wet, soaking wet and unconscious, and leaving him in a cold alley at night, where he later died of hypothermia. Without those cameras, we never would have known the truth of the scenario. And it's important that we get to the truth if we're going to address these really, really long-standing and deep-rooted problems within policing and corrections. Because here's the other question. Who do the prisoners call when they are raped, beaten, or otherwise tortured and harassed by corrections officials? The police? Just this year, the RCMP settled one of the largest class action suits in a scenario where female officers and female civilian workers had alleged that there was widespread, long-standing sexual harassment, discrimination, and even sexual abuse within the RCMP by its male officers. And while it didn't admit any wrongdoing, of course, it did engage in a final settlement that would pay out millions of dollars to all of these women who've long suffered abuse at the hands of male RCMP officers. But that's not the only class action suit. There's also a class action suit by the male RCMP officers who are alleging harassment, bullying, physical assaults, and it's something that they have alleged is long-standing and has caused them stress, post-traumatic stress, have required medical leaves from work, and we can only imagine what else they've had to deal with when recent reports about unwanted sexual touching, nudity, harassment, intimidation, and other kinds of abuse have been alleged from the police's own policing college in Ottawa, of all places. So it's very clear that the RCMP have some pretty significant issues around sexualized violence and harassment. But it's not just sexual abuse and harassment and bullying and physical abuse that has plagued the RCMP. There's also the big issue of corruption. A recent report by the RCMP found literally hundreds of examples of police corruption by hundreds of RCMP officers. And while they tried to downplay it, they also admitted that while it wasn't on the end of the most extreme kind of corruption, it was in the mid-range. And to us, any kind of corruption, any kind at all, is really a problem for the safety and security of Canadians, of Indigenous peoples, and those who are most vulnerable. And those are those who are trapped or caught or detained by RCMP police officers, either on the street, in their police vehicles, in their temporary detention centers, or in interactions with hospitals, and also in terms of any interactions they have in prisons. It's a very serious issue, because if you take sexual assault and physical violence and you pair that with corruption and the high degree to which they lie and commit perjury, then you've got a scenario where they can commit these crimes with relative impunity. And that is part of the problem in terms of addressing it on a go-forward basis. This isn't a new issue. Police racism, sexism, corruption, and abuse is long-standing. It has been noted in the Royal Commission on the Donald Marshall wrongful prosecution, where they noted that the only reason why Donald Marshall was wrongfully prosecuted was because the police, his lawyers, and the judges all treated him differently because he was Native. You have the Manitoba Justice Inquiry, which was instigated because of the failures of police to properly investigate and prosecute the sexual assault and murder of Helen Betty Osborne, an Indigenous woman from northern Manitoba, and the police shooting of unarmed Indigenous leader J.J. Harper. And the Manitoba Justice Inquiry also noted racism, also noted bad relationships with the police, and specifically noted that it's Indigenous women and children that suffer the most but get the least amount of protection. Now, we're talking about reports that were issued well over 20 years ago. But you also have reports like the Opal Inquiry's Missing Women Commission, which highlighted systemic bias by RCMP, failures to follow their own protocols, which is a cause for why many of the murdered and missing investigations never happened or never happened properly. And those aren't the only ones. If you look at the Ipperwash Inquiry, which was the shooting of unarmed land defender Dudley George, you have the Ipperwash Inquiry that said very specifically, this is not a case of one or two bad apples, that racism in the Ontario police force is widespread and it needs a widespread solution. And this is what we're saying as advocates for justice, that there needs to be a widespread solution. But there seems to be a really big resistance on the part of all federal governments, all provincial governments, to actually expose the problem and then come up with comprehensive solutions to deal with it. Take, for example, the self-declared feminist Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. Where has he been on any of these issues about exposing police and corrections abuses and addressing them? He hasn't been anywhere. And a real feminist would look at the serious threat to both female corrections officers and female prisoners in terms of what policing and corrections does within those institutions. And that, I mean, that's a real problem. But it's not just there. If you look at Minister Ralph Goodale, he's one of the most experienced ministers. He's been the minister of just about every department you could imagine. He's now the Minister of Public Safety. Where has he been? I mean, the RCMP has recently even admitted that it has a racist police force. If you can't address a substantive issue like racism from an admission and sexism from the settled class action and all of the abuses and corruption that have already been proven in reports, what more does Minister Goodale need to actually act in the public's best interest for the safety of those that are imprisoned and those that are on the outside that have to deal with police and corrections? But it's not just those two. Where is Minister Maryam Monsef? She's the Minister for the Status of Women. You would think with all these very public and blatant abuses of women all across the country in various formats, that she would be literally screaming from the top of her lungs to make sure that this was addressed for the female corrections officers, for the female RCMP officers, female police officers, all of the women and girls that are imprisoned in Canada's institutions, and all of those Indigenous women and girls who have been raped, assaulted, or abused by RCMP and other police officers, which have been documented in reports like Human Rights Watch, and there have been calls by the United Nations for Canada to look into its own police forces. So far, nothing. And that really concerns me because this is the background and context to the National Inquiry on Murdered and Missing Indigenous Women. All roads lead back to the police, police forces, and their racism, sexism, abuse, and corruption. Both their physical attacks on Indigenous women and girls and their failure to protect them when they are murdered or abused or go missing by other people. There has been a complete failure when it comes to Indigenous women and girls. Yet the National Inquiry, which you think would be an ideal tool to actually focus a light on these really dark places, expose the problems in policing and corrections, and come up with substantive solutions, what the inquiry did instead, through its terms of reference, was insulate the police. Insulate it in terms of they won't open all of the cases, they won't open ongoing cases, and more importantly, they won't investigate police behavior. If anyone has a complaint about a specific police officer, they're redirected back to the same police force that wouldn't act on the complaint to begin with. So there's really no interest in getting at the truth when it comes to policing and corrections, and that's a huge problem. It should be no surprise then that when they set up this National Inquiry, they appointed a commissioner, Commissioner Robinson, whose husband is not only an RCMP officer, not only did parliamentary detail and has a very close relationship to Canada's cabinet, but in fact pled guilty to assaulting Indigenous prisoners himself. I mean, why on earth would you appoint a commissioner whose husband has been found guilty of beating Indigenous prisoners and who she herself defended her husband and tried to blame the RCMP for the incident? This really goes to show there's a fundamental lack of leadership, that the thin blue line of police officers and corrections officers extends not only to their police unions and leadership, but also to Canada's very own federal and provincial governments. And that's a problem. What we need is a massive public inquiry that looks directly at policing and corrections abuses in this country and makes substantive changes. If federal and provincial governments don't take immediate action to make drastic changes to policing and corrections to guarantee the safety of female police officers and corrections officers, as well as the public at large, it's going to continue to erode faith in the policing, corrections, and justice system, and it will become itself a national crisis. Because when those who are hired to serve and protect serve their own interests and abuse the human rights of others, then we no longer live in a democracy. And certainly this is not what the treaty relationship had envisioned. So it's time that the federal and provincial governments do something about this. So I'm calling on Prime Minister Trudeau, Minister Goodale, Minister Monsef, Minister Bennett, Minister Philpott, and the entire cabinet to take the bold steps needed to uncover the mess that is Canada's policing, corrections, and justice system, and make sure that changes are implemented that protect those who must deal with policing, including those that work in those police forces, that work in corrections, and those who are most vulnerable to their abuses, those who are imprisoned, and those people who must interact with policing and corrections on an everyday basis. Thank you for watching my new YouTube channel, State of the Nations. If you want to see more content, please consider subscribing below, sharing the link with your family, friends, and other activists, and leave me a comment. Let me know what other kinds of shows you would like to hear about. Thanks.